My name is Pavel Doroshkin. I work as a head of product management and application department at NT-MDT, and today I would like to talk about the chip enhanced Raman sketching, the technique which allows us to break the optical diffraction limit and to reach the chemical Raman maps with a resolution coming close to 10 nanometers. This is the webinar, which is very similar to the one that we made this spring. We had a lot of people who couldn't join at that time, so we had a lot of requests to repeat the webinar, so that's why we repeat the webinar with a little bit of the new data, but basically it's very similar to what we showed in spring. So here you can see the brief outlook of what I'm going to talk about. First, I'll show you the working principle and the instrumentation of the chip enhanced Raman device produced by NT-MDT. Next, I will demonstrate you a few examples of a classical confocal Raman fluorescence microscopy integrated with AFM. There will not be any super resolution data. The data resolution will be limited by diffraction by about 200 nanometers with visible light. And the main part of my talk will be devoted to the tip-enhanced Raman sketching. I will demonstrate the nano-Raman imaging data for the graphene, for silicon nanostructures, for organic molecules, and so on. So I would like to start with this basic slide, which will remind us that atomic force microscopy is a universal technique for surface analysis, basically able to provide any physical information about the sample properties, sample surface properties. So here include the flash animations for the Kelvin probe microscopy, which is the technique to study the surface potential or local work function of the sample. Next is magnetic force microscopy, the technique measuring the sample magnetization with a high lateral resolution. And finally, the force modulation microscopy is the technique to measure local elastical properties of the sample. All these techniques have a dozen of nanometer scale, resolution, and provide us the information about different physical properties of the surface. Altogether, there are a lot of different modes of atomic force microscope. Many of them are listed on this slide, and they provide the information about capacitance, surface potential, local resistivity by spreading resistance, adhesion forces, electrostatic forces, magnetic forces, and so on and so forth. So basically, again, that every physical property of the surface can be studied by atomic force microscope with a very high spatial resolution. What is typically lacking in the AFM is the chemical specificity of the obtained maps, and of course, to get the chemical information about the surface composition, about the nanostructures composition, we need to apply optical microscopy and spectroscopy techniques, and one of the most widely used techniques for the chemical analysis is the Raman spectroscopy. This is the technique of the inelastic light sketching. The monochromatic light from the laser passes through the crystal lattice on a molecule, and it kill, the photon can lose the energy and excite the certain vibration state of the molecule or of the crystal lattice, and each vibration state is designated on the Raman spectrum, which is intensity of the past or back reflected photons as a function of the photon energy with respect to the original photon energy of the laser. So then the Raman spectrum gives us exact information about the energy of the vibrations in the sample, molecular crystal lattice vibrations, and it can correspondingly give us the compositional information about the sample, because different chemical species have different characteristic Raman bands. So then to do together physical and chemical characterization of the sample, we need to integrate AFM with Raman and fluorescence spectroscopy techniques. This is the equipment which is doing this job. It consists on the confocal Raman system. It's a powerful confocal Raman spectrometer equipped with very many different lasers, invisible ultraviolet, near-infrared range with a set of gratings, multiple detectors, polarizers, beam expanders. And this is the very important part of the confocal Raman microscope. This is the confocal pinhole. This is actually the pinhole which specially localizes the area from which we collect the signal from the sample. So with the confocal approach, we are able, confocal system is able to reach the diffraction limited resolution, which for visible light is usually typically limited to about 200 nanometers in XY and about 500 nanometers in Z. Now we take this confocal Raman module and integrate it with an atomic force microscope. Here you can see the outlook of this setup. This is the high resolution, high numerical aperture lens. This is the AFM cantilever, and this is the sample. So on the next flash animation, I will show how it's working in the real time, and I will keep silence for a few seconds because if I show the flash animation, my voice cannot go through. There is not enough connection, internet throughput. So I'll just demonstrate you how the system runs. So I demonstrated you on the flash video how we can easily change the lasers, the polarizers, the gratings. All this is motorized and it's very convenient to run a good tip-enhanced Raman or AFM Raman experiment because we need to go through different wavelengths in the experiment and to go through different polarizations of the laser light. Now we integrate again this confocal module with the Raman, with the AFM. And the most important thing for this integration is to have the tip, the AFM cantilever, located under the very high numerical aperture, very high resolution objective. In the upright configuration, which you can see on the corner, we use the 100x objective with a numerical aperture 0.7, which effectively corresponds to a 90 degree collection angle of the objective, and the laser spot size on the sample is 400 nanometers. We also have the option in liquid. In this case, we use 1.0 numerical aperture lens, which corresponds to about 120 degree collection angle of the light and about 280 nanometer size of the lasers for the resolution. So we can do that. We can use the lens to focus the laser light exactly to the end of the tip to study all this physical effects happening between the three objects, between the sample, between the light, the monochromatic light, or it can be a white light as well, and between the tip, the specially prepared tip, or standard AFM cantilever. So we can do this in a controlled atmosphere, and with a controlled temperature as well, and we can also do this AFM Raman and tip-enhanced Raman experiments in liquid. And the most, also the very important thing, to be able to use different AFM probes. So you can see here the AFM cantilever under the high resolution lens, but sometimes you want to use as a probe, as an AFM probe, the STM cantilever, sorry, the STM tip, and in this case you just change the sample holder, the rest of the system is the same, and you put the STM tip under the tightly focused laser beam. Also, if your probe, if your TERS probe, tip-enhanced Raman probe, is the for example, etched metal wire, then this metal wire can be glued to the tuning fork. The tuning fork force, works as the force feedback for the AFM, and if, effectively any probe, any sharp object can be used as a probe, as a TERS probe to be used in the system. Again, this can be done also in the control temperature atmosphere. So this is the upright configuration for non-transparent samples. And for transparent samples, we have a specially designated inverted configuration that does the same job, but in this case, the sample is transparent. It should be a microscope cover slip or a thin glass. Then we can use the lens focusing from the bottom objective. It can be oil immersion objective, thus giving us the very high numerical aperture, very high collection angles, and the AFM is placed from the top. Usually this inverting configuration is used for tip-enhanced Raman in biological studies or in studies of the small nanomaterials, nanochips, nanowires, nanoparticles. These materials can be deposited on the microscope cover slit and they can be imaged in the inverted configuration. Same thing, we can use the STM tip, tuning fork probe, we can do it in a controlled atmosphere, in controlled temperature, and in liquid. So then I'm going to move forward to just one more slide, and this is the most universal configuration which one could imagine, integration of the AFM with different optics. This is the actually existing system which is working in quite a few customers of NT-MDT. This is integration of the bottom illumination lens with as high as possible numerical resolution. It can be 1.49 NA or even 1.5 NA. From the top, we keep a very high resolution lens, 0.7 NA in air. And from the side, there is also a high numerical aperture lens. So that gives us the universal optical approach to the tip. The tip can be placed in the focal point of all three lenses, from the top, from the bottom, and from the side, and we can do the universal experiments. We can combine any type of excitation and collection. For example, top excitation, bottom collection, side excitation, top collection, and so on. So this basically provides the universal integration of atomic force microscopy techniques with optical techniques. And there are a lot of physics which can be studied behind that. Today I will mainly concentrate on the tip-enhanced Raman scattering. This is when this AFM probe is enhancing our Raman signal. There are a lot of scanners with the system. So there is a special mirror scanning from the top, mirror scanning from the bottom. Tip can scan, sample can scan X, Y, Z, and all the objectives also can scan in Z direction. All the scanners are the closed loop piezo scanners with a nanometer precision and nanometer temporal stability. So then, just to show you the photo of the system, this is the specifically upright configuration when the lens is from the top of the AFM cantilever and from on the top of the sample. Here you can see the high numerical aperture lens. Under the lens there is a cantilever, and under the cantilever is the sample. And on the back side, you can see the Raman spectrometer. And I will start to show the data with a very simple, very basic Raman map. This is a standard test sample, mineralic toothpaste with a titanium oxide particles inside. This titanium oxide has a specific, strong specific Raman bands. So we map the intensity of the Raman band, titanium oxide Raman band, as a function of X and Y position of the laser spot on the sample. And we can see by chance sometimes nanoparticles which are very closely spaced to each other. There are two nanoparticles 200 nanometers apart. And each nanoparticle itself is a few dozen of nanometer size. But on the Raman image they of course become larger because the laser spot focus on the sample is diffraction limited. It's about half of the wavelength, which for the blue laser gives us about 200 nanometer size of the laser spot and 200 nanometer of confocal imaging resolution. But still, if your experiment lies within this range, within micron scale range, this 200 nanometer resolution of Raman together with AFM provides a lot of meaningful information, and I will show you. But if we want to go to the lower resolution, we need to apply the tip-enhanced, tip-assisted optical techniques, tip-assisted Raman, tip-assisted fluorescence, and so on. So in this simple chart, I'll just repeat the idea that the optical microscope has a resolution limited to about 250 nanometers. With the confocal principle, we can reach about 200 nanometers or even 180 nanometers. With visible light of the lateral resolution of the optical microscopy. While the AFM, of course, goes much farther, it goes to the nanometer scale, and then, you know, the Angstrom scale resolution. So the general idea behind integrating AFM and optical techniques is that somehow the AFM should help us to move, to push the resolution of optical techniques down to at least 10 nanometers or even lower. So this is what is called tip-assisted optical microscopy, and part of this is the tip-enhanced Raman microscopy or tip-enhanced Raman spectroscopy. And I will start with a classical confocal imaging. I'll show you a few slides of the AFM working together with a classical Raman setup without any super resolution. This is the picture of the AFM cantilever and the laser spot tightly focused to the end of the cantilever. You can see that spot hits exactly the end of the cantilever. This is the end of the cantilever. This is the laser spot. And that's when we're scanning the sample, we obtain the optical and AFM information exactly from the same sample area. And this is the graphene monolayer, double layer, triple layer, and the multiple layer flame. So now what we do, let's look at this flash. We have the graphene sample. We put the AFM probe, focus from the top into the laser into a very small spot and collect the Raman signal and measure, scan the sample and measure AFM and Raman maps simultaneously. This is the flash simulation of the real-time experiment we made in our lab, and this shows as the simultaneous AFM topography, AFM phase imaging, and optical imaging. On the right-hand side is the confocal relay map. This is the elastically scattered light intensity, intensity of the G-band of the graphene, and finally this one is the hyperspectral confocal Raman map. This is when we record the complete Raman spectrum at every single pixel of the whole scan. So at the end we have 100 by 100 pixel Raman map where at every pixel we have the full Raman spectrum. So it's very, it can be very fast imaging if the laser power is high enough and if the sample produces a lot of Raman scattering, like graphene is okay for that, we can get the 100 by 100 point AFM and Raman scan for about 1 minute. Then let's look at the data. This is the AFM topography data, which shows us the graphene flakes on the gold sample. The gold surface is pretty rough in our case, while the flat areas are the graphene flakes. From the topography, we can judge about, preliminary judge about number of flakes. This is presumably the single monolayer flake. This is the double monolayer flake. And this is the area with multiple layers. Raman map gives us more concrete information about the number of layers. By the intensity of the G-band, we can judge that this is the single layer, this is the double layer, and this is the multiple layer area. And of course, even more direct way to study the amount of flakes in the graphene is the position and shape of the second order D-band in the graphene. And here, by plotting the 2D band mass center, we can easily distinguish between single layer, double layer, and multiple layer graphene flakes. The confocal relay map also demonstrates a very nice contrast between the sample surface and between the graphene flakes. Single layer and double layer and multiple layers, and they produce a good optical contrast with respect to each other and with respect to the gold substrate. Next, we want to apply advanced AFM techniques. They can be measured at the same time with Raman as I showed you. Sometimes we need to switch from one type of cantilever to another type of the cantilever. We can switch the cantilevers not losing the place in the sample. So by putting the contact cantilever, we can do, for example, lateral force microscopy together with Raman or separately with Raman on the same place of the sample. And here we can see the friction coefficient as a function of number of layers. So you can see a high friction on the gold substrate, a lower friction on the single monolayer, and even low, much lower friction on the double layer and multiple layer flakes. So this is the corresponding profile. The lateral force gradually drops down by increasing the number of layers in the graphene. Next, Kelvin probe microscopy measures the local surface potential of the sample. There's a high contrast between the substrate and the graphene. And the number of, while increasing the number of the graphene flakes, we see the gradual increase of the local surface potential of the sample. Electrostatic force microscopy gives us an idea about the charge distribution on the sample. Force modulation microscopy, as I mentioned, measures the local elastic properties of the sample. And here we can see a very soft gold substrate and a hard monolayer and a slightly harder double and multiple layers. So we can see a very small contrast between a single layer and double or multiple layers. So this is the summary of all the experiment. We did it in the same experimental run by just changing the cantilevers when we switch from one AFM mode to the other. And here from the same sample we get the different physical information about the sample by lateral force microscopy, electrostatic force microscopy, force modulation, capacitance microscopy, Kelvin probe microscopy, and of course the optical information. The Raman information gives us idea about number of flakes, or gives us actually exact information about number of flakes, 1, 2, 3, or it's more. Then also with Raman imaging we can look at the defects, at the impurities on the graphene or on many other samples. And the last example I'll give you from the classical Raman microscopy. This is again the confocal resolution limited microscopy, 200 nanometer limited microscopy for immersion optics. Here is the mixture of two polymers, polystyrene and PVAC materials. So on the AFM we can see that this there are certain domain structures which are presumably PVAC domains in the polystyrene matrix. From the surface potential we can very nicely see a high surface potential of the domains which can be attributed to the perpendicular dipole magnetic moment, perpendicular dipole moment of the polyvinyl acetate chains. So preliminary from the surface potential we can judge that this is the PVAC polyvinyl acetate domains in the polystyrene matrix. But of course to get the exact chemical composition and to know this effect for sure we need the Raman microscopy. And this is again the similar sample. Here we have the AFM height and surface potential showing us the domains. And on the right hand side are the Raman maps simultaneously measured in the same area. And we can see that indeed the PVAC Raman band is on in the domains. So these are PVAC domains. And the matrix is the polystyrene matrix. And if we look closer at the single point spectrum, for example, taken in the center of the domain, we can see that this is the pure PVAC domain. There is no intermixture of the PVAC polymer with the polystyrene. So this is a pure PVAC domain in the pure polystyrene matrix. To know this fact, we need the Raman microscopy correlated with the AFM imaging of the height, surface potential, and so on. And let's look at this part of the image. Here we have two small domains, and the size is just 200 nanometers, and they're about 200 nanometers apart from each other. And this is already slightly below the resolution limit of the optics. In our case, it was the air objective with a 400 nanometer resolution. So we can hardly already resolve these two domains because we reached the resolution limit of classical confocal microscopy. And in this case, if we want to look close into the sample, we need to apply the tip enhanced Raman scattering techniques. So this is the idea behind the tip enhanced Raman scattering. You can see that there is a tightly focused laser spot. We can focus it into as small as 200 nanometers for the blue light and for the immersion optics. And this is the specially prepared nano antenna. It's usually a metal AFM or STM probe. And the idea behind this nano antenna is that it should attract and localize the incoming electromagnetic field. So in the word of nano antenna is used because the incoming electromagnetic radiation by different physical effects gets focused to the end of the nano antenna, to the end of the tip, and gets locally enhanced many orders of magnitude. So presently there are different approaches to build such nano antennas, but in most of the cases the nano antennas are based on the localized surface plasmon resonance. The surface localized surface plasmon is the oscillation of electron density, as shown on this picture, with respect to the positive metal core at the end of the metal or of the metallized tip. So such oscillation frequency depends on the material, the metal material, and depend on the shape of the tip, but typically we want to be in resonance with this localized surface plasmon. So to be in resonance with visible light, usually people use either gold or silver probes, because gold and silver nanoparticles have resonances in visible regions. So they can be coupled resonantly with a visible region Raman excitation lasers. So then we use the laser, which is in resonance with the localized surface plasmon, and the energy of the laser is effectively pumped or transferred into the localized surface plasmon oscillation, and the tip, the localized surface plasmon, effectively re-emits the radiation of exactly the same frequency as the incoming laser, but now it is re-emitted and it's localized at the very end of the nano antenna, at the very end of the tip. Typically, the localization area for sharp tips reaches a dozen of nanometers. So that allows us to scan the tip with respect to the sample, or scan the samples with respect to the tip, and by getting the optical response from the sample and from the tip, we can obtain the optical maps of the sample, but the resolution of these maps will not be now determined by the size of the laser spot, but it will be determined by the light localization area near the TERS tip, near the nano antenna. So I would like to go on this animation through the main steps behind the tip-enhanced Raman scattering experiment, or actually I would like to call it more widely, it's a tip-assisted optical experiment. It can be the tip-enhanced fluorescence, it can be just tip stimulated relay scattering of the signal, or it can be tip-enhanced Raman. I will mainly in this talk concentrate on the tip-enhanced Raman, but from the point of view of instrumentation and experimental procedure, all tip-assisted techniques are basically the same or very similar, again, from the point of view of the experimental setup. So the first thing, let's take the sample, like a carbon nanotube, for example. And the first thing we need to do is to take the lens, the high numerical aperture lens, and to focus the laser into the as small as possible spot. So with our system, with the top illumination lens, we use 400 nanometer diameter of the laser spot. When we use bottom illumination lens, we can use oil immersion, and then we reach 200 nanometer diameter laser spot. Why it has to be as small as possible, I will later talk about it, but this is a really important fact. So, next thing is that we need to take the specially prepared TERS active tip-enhanced Raman active probe and position it near the laser spot and approach it to the sample. So, it has to be in contact with the sample. Next thing, we need to position the laser spot very precisely with respect to the TERS tip. So for doing that, we scan, we use a mirror scanner to scan very carefully across the area around the tip. So now the laser spot is scanning around the tip, and we are collecting simultaneously relay scattered, elastically scattered light intensity by the same objective, and intensity of the Raman from the nanotube. So, and let's look while we are scanning. At the moment when we hit the tip by the laser spot, there is a sharp increase in the elastically scattered light intensity, the Rayleigh scattered light. And also, if the tip is Raman active, if it can increase the Raman signal near itself, then we will also see the increase of the intensity from the carbon nanotube. So you can see the low intensity now of the Raman signal from the nanotube while we're away from the spot. When we're away from the tip, when the laser spot hits the tip, we can see the increase of the intensity from the Raman intensity from the sample, because the tip localizes electromagnetic field in the small area around, and it enhances the electromagnetic response from the sample. In this case, this is the Raman response. So What we need to do, we need to finish this scan. This is a very precise scan with a nanometer precision. And then we should tell the software that here is our hotspot. Here is where the tip, the TERS active tip, is touching the sample and is enhancing the Raman signal from the sample. And we need to position the laser spot into this hotspot, into the hotspot on the tip with a very high precision. It has to be at least a dozen of nanometers precision and temporal stability. So after doing that, we will always keep the laser spot in the same position with respect to the tip. And the last thing to do is to scan with a sample. So we scan the sample, and we simultaneously obtain topography, another AFM maps, and a Raman map. So you can see what's happening when the laser spot, this is the tightly focused laser spot, when the laser spot hits the nanotube, we can see a relatively weak Raman signal. So here you can see the representation of the Raman photons. And indeed, but when the tip itself hits the nanotube, then the number of Raman photons is largely increased, order of magnitude increased, and you get the enhanced signal. So as a result of this scan, we should obtain the map, the Raman map, which is shown on the bottom. So let's finish this. Okay, so on the bottom you can see the results in Raman map. You can see this wide area, it's a classical confocal Raman image from the nanotube. It is obtained by using the whole laser spot, and it has a relatively small intensity, while on the top of it we can see a very bright, a very sharp image of the nanotube, the Raman image, and the sharpness there of this image is determined by the light localization at the tip. And the intensity of this TERS, or near field, how people call it, image, is much higher than the intensity of the rest of the image, with a classic, which is a classical confocal Raman, or the so-called far-field Raman image. So again, we can see here non-enhanced Raman map and enhanced Raman map together. And the enhanced Raman map has much higher resolution. So let's look at the actual, before that, just to summarize the main steps behind the TERS experiment. So first is to prepare the TERS active probe or nano antenna. I will briefly talk about that later. Next is to focus the laser light into the smallest possible spot on the sample. And I'd like to mention that there are different types of the nano antennas, and not always we necessarily need to focus the tip, the laser light exactly to the end of the tip. Sometimes we need to focus the laser light somewhere a little bit apart from the end of the tip, usually to excite the propagating surface plasmons. So it can be sometimes off-axis excitation, so not exactly the excitation at the end of the tip, but the fact that we have to focus the laser light into the smallest possible spot still remains valid. In all or most of the nano-antenna geometries, the tight focusing of the laser spot at the end of the nano-antenna or a little bit away from the end of nano-antenna is very crucial. Then we need to position the TERS probe inside the excitation laser spot with very high precision. And finally, scan the sample to get the TERS map. This is what I demonstrated on the previous flash animation. Now we remind that we have different configuration for tip enhanced Raman scattering. It can be inverted configuration, and up to recently most of the experiments in the tip enhanced Raman or other tip assisted optical techniques were performed in the inverted configuration. Why is that? The answer is very simple. There are two reasons. First reason is that the tip and the light come from completely opposite sides, so there are absolutely zero effects of the tip shadowing of the light. And the second very important thing, most important thing, is the fact that it's possible to use the oil immersion optics from the bottom. The oil immersion optics guarantees us very high excitation angles, very high collection angles, and very small laser spot. All this is very critical for tip-assisted optical techniques. So More challenging configuration is when the sample is in when the sample is not transparent. In this case, the illumination has to come from the top or from the side, and the collection can be done also from the side, but it's not very good configuration. It should come from the top. So I will talk about all of these three configurations to support all three of them, and it will also support the configuration with all three lenses together, from the bottom, from the top, and from the side. And let's look at the data. I will start with the inverted configuration. This is the first part of the experiment. We take the cantilever and we grow a scan with the cantilever across the laser spot, and we measure the back reflected the intensity of the elastically scattered light. So what we see, and this is the approximately the our laser spot, about 250 nanometer diameter, and inside the laser spot we can see two bright lobes which correspond to the maximum of the back scattered signal. So that means that when the tip is at these places, there is maximum interaction of the focused laser light with the localized surface plasmon on the tip. The fact that there is these are two lobes is connected to the fact that there is a non-uniform configuration of electromagnetic field polarization inside the laser spot. And in these two lobes, the polarization has the highest component in the Z direction, in the direction along the tip. So this Z polarization is the crucial for the tip enhanced Raman scattering experiment, and the best Z polarization conditions are reached in the certain places within the laser spot. So now we have to position the tip very precisely inside this laser spot, inside the single lobe, and we have to see to understand that the size of this lobe is about 50 nanometers, so we need to position the tip inside with about 10 nanometer precision. And we have to keep there the tip in this place of the laser spot for the next few minutes, perhaps can be few hours, for the rest of the tip enhanced Raman scattering experiment while we are scanning the sample. So I will show some, first of all, some point enhancement data. This is when we just take the tip, position it precisely inside the laser spot, and we bring the tip closer to the sample in the feedback, in the AFM feedback with the sample, a few nanometers from the sample, and then we can see the enhancement of the Raman signal. So this is the example of the buckyball thin layer on the transparent sample, and the blue is the non-enhanced Raman signal, which shows certain Raman bands of the C60 molecules. When we bring the tip inside the laser spot, we see the enhanced Raman spectrum. Different bands are enhanced different ways, but usually, typically, there is about 4 to 8 times enhancement. This is, I'm talking about the so-called net enhancement. This is when we use exactly the same acquisition time, we just compare two spectra with the tip and with the, without the tip. If we want to talk about the local enhancement, about the enhancement which is normalized to the area on the sample, we have to take into account that the bottom spectrum is the far field signal, and it comes from the large area on the sample. It comes from the area which is equal to the area of the laser spot, which is say 200 by 200 nanometers or more. While the enhanced signal mostly comes from a very small area, about 20 by 20 or even less nanometers around the tip. So the net enhancement of 10 times, when recalculated, renormalized to the difference, to the ratio of the emission areas, gives us the enhancement factor of the actual intensity near the tip, light density near the tip. Surface density of light. The light density is enhanced many orders of magnitude, so by at least 2, even 3 orders of magnitude. The approach curves here on the right-hand slide show the tip sample distance and enhancement factor as a function of the tip sample distance. So we can see, let's look at this sharp curve here on the bottom. We can see that only when the tip comes very close to the sample, less than 10 nanometers to the sample, there is large enhancement of the Raman signal. This is because we are observing the true near field effect, the effect, the enhancement effect, which is localized near the end of the chip. So the bottom line is shown for the shear force feedback regime. This is when the tip is oscillating with a few nanometer amplitude in the horizontal direction. For the AFM cantilever in the tapping mode with a vertical oscillation regime, the curve, the approach curve is not that steep. This is because the cantilever has a certain a few dozen of nanometer oscillation amplitude. And that means that even when we're still 30 nanometers away from the surface, that is already part of the oscillation cycle of the cantilever, which the cantilever stays near the surface. That's why the curve for the AFM tapping mode is not as steep as the curve for the shear force. Next approach curve is there for the vanadium oxide thin layer on a transparent substrate, and we can see again the five-field Raman spectrum not showing any pronounced Raman bands. When we bring the TERS tip closer and closer to the sample, a few nanometers from the sample, we can see that the huge enhancement is appearing of the Raman bands on the sample. So I show you this. This is the so-called point tip enhanced Raman spectroscopy. It is an interesting fundamental research area because it allows people to study the light sample interaction on the nanometer scale to obtain the Raman signals from the nanometer scale areas, even coming down to the single molecule Raman spectroscopy. But of course, what we would ideally like to see is not the spectrum in a single point, but actually the map. So the two-dimensional distribution of the Raman intensity across the sample, because this will actually give us the true chemical composition across the sample with a very high lateral resolution. So I'm moving down to this imaging, source imaging data. I'll start from the data which was published by our colleagues in Eindhoven University, Professor Loss and Professor DeWitt and Günther Hoffmann group in collaboration with the NT-MDT. And this is the on the right-hand slide, you can see the confocal Raman image of the single-walled carbon nanotube bundle. The bundle itself is about 5 nanometer diameter, but on the image, you can see it becomes about 250 nanometer width on the Raman image because this is the diffraction limit. This is a confocal Raman map. The laser spot size on the sample is about 250 nanometers. The black spectrum is the non-enhanced Raman spectrum. The enhanced Raman spectrum is shown by red. We can see RBM, D-line, G-line, and the D-line overtone. All are enhanced, but they enhanced a little bit different different ways because as a background, you can see the fluorescence background coming from the plasmon, so we can see that the localized surface plasmon is mostly concentrated about 630 nanometers near the laser. While we're moving away from the laser, the resonance, the surface plasmon resonance, is decreasing, and the enhancement of Raman bands is decreasing. So the next thing to do is to do the mapping, and this is the TERS map already. And if you remember the flash animation I showed a few slides before, this is what was predicted. You can see the five-field image. This is the low-resolution five-field image, the low intensity of the single-walled carbon nanotube bundle. While on the top of it, we see a very bright, a very sharp image showing the single-walled carbon nanotube bundle of about 50 nanometer thickness on the image. So that tells us that the resolution of this Raman map is about 50 nanometers, and this is actually the Raman map, the G-line intensity map. So this was one of the first demonstrations of nano-Raman imaging on the commercial system. Maybe we were the first one with such high resolution with the commercial system. This was published in 2007, and since then a lot of things moved forward, and we have a lot of customers doing tip-enhanced Raman scattering experiments, and I'm very happy to demonstrate here the data from some of our customers, and the first data comes from the group of Professor Sergei Kazarian. The experiment was done by Andrew Chan, and this is the again Raman near field Raman imaging, enhanced Raman imaging of a single walled carbon nanotube mixture. On the right hand side, you can see the micro Raman map, where there can not be seen any details of the sample because the resolution of the micro Raman map is too low. Let's look at the scale, about 200 nanometer scale. Then on the next, on the left hand map, we can see already the TERS map on the same scale from the same sample. And now we can already see the structure of the single walled carbon nanotubes, so the small bundles of nanotubes, with a resolution which can be judged by the cross section of the Raman map and which can be estimated to be at least 14 nanometers. So in this work, the researchers were able to differentiate between metallic and semiconducting single walled carbon nanotubes within the mixture and between the amorphous carbon, with a resolution about 14 nanometers. This was done with a gold-coated contact cantilever and with a red laser. Our next experiment comes from the group of the Eindhoven University again, and this is probably one of the first successful attempts for the TERS imaging of the polymer systems. This is, again, the polymer blend. It's a mixture of SAN and PMMA polymer. And here we can see the low resolution maps on the top and high resolution maps on the bottom. Here we plot the intensity of the SAN Raman band on the left and of the PMMA Raman band on the right. If we look at the left part of the slide, then we can see the conventional confocal Raman intensity, which is pretty weak, and the fluorescence is pretty high here from the polymer. While in the TERS map, we can see the small enhancement of the fluorescence, but if you just a couple of times enhancement of the fluorescence, while the TERS signal is greatly enhanced, the Raman part of the signal is greatly enhanced. And now it allows us to scan the Raman, it allows the researchers in this publication to scan the Raman map with a high speed because of the high signal with the TERS and with a high lateral resolution because of the localization of the electromagnetic field at the TERS. And also the fluorescence background is less problem with the TERS than with confocal. So then this is the high resolution Raman map, and here scientists could see the initial phase separation process between the SAN and PMMA polymer phases. That was done for the sample at 250 degrees annealed at 2 minutes. The higher annealing for a longer time, higher temperature annealing gave the more sharp boundaries in the domain boundaries. That was done with the inverted configuration with the transparent samples. So I would like to show the data with the non-transparent samples, which I mentioned already is the most challenging from the experimental point of view. So we exploit two different approaches. The first one is the true side illumination with a separate high numerical aperture lens, exciting the sample from the side, and we did the collection from the top and also collection from the side, but this is the very inefficient way. We also tried to use the same, and our customers tried to use the same objective illumination and collection as on the left part. And this configuration appears to be much more effective from the point of view of TERS signal and easiness of the TERS experiment. And to do the effective side illumination, to eliminate the shadowing on the tip and to produce the good component of the Z-polarized light, the light polarized along the normal to the sample plane, vertically polarized light. We use the linearly polarized light, and we use the part of the aperture of the lens to focus to the tip. So the green is the excitation laser, and thanks to the high numerical aperture of the lens, we can do the side illumination by about 45 degrees by using the same top illumination lamps. At the same time, collection is done through the same lens, through the same objective, and we're using the whole 0.7 numerical aperture because we need to minimize the collection volume on the sample. If we use the smaller aperture, then we will collect the signal from the very large area on the sample, and we will collect a huge background, the non-enhanced signal from the sample, because the enhanced signal comes only from the small area near the tip, while non-enhanced signal comes from the whole sample where the laser is focused, from the whole laser focal point volume. That's why we need to minimize the collection volume from the sample to minimize the background, non-enhanced background for the sample. So I will show you the few examples of this data. The first is the graphene. This is the graphene flake. We scan, as I showed on the flash video, we scan with a laser spot across the graphene flake, X and Y. So we scan it like this across the, and here's the cantilever. And we collect the Raman signal by the spectrometer while scanning with the laser spot. And we can see that when the laser hits the end of the cantilever, there is a sharp increase of the Raman intensity from the graphene. And this is because now the tip is in touch with the sample and is enhancing the intensity of the graphene band. So let's look at the spectrum. The black is the non-enhanced spectrum and the red is the enhanced spectrum. That's about four times net enhancement for the graphene in the upright configuration. That's not maximum what we could see. Maximum we could see up to 12 or even 15 times enhancement. I'll show the data. And the green is the spectrum from the tip itself. This is to confirm that the tip is clean and does not produce any G-band from the carbon, for example. So the tip is clean. Next thing to check for the tip enhanced Raman is whether this is a resonant effect, whether this is a true tip enhanced Raman effect, is to change the laser, and we can see that for different laser wavelengths, we can see totally different enhancement factors. So for the green laser, the enhancement factor is about 5 or 7 times. For the blue laser is about 2 times enhancement, and for the red laser, there is no enhancement. So this is a very nice indication of the fundamental principles of the tip enhanced Raman sketching. This is the resonant effect, the effect of the resonance between the excitation laser and the localized surface plasmon at the end of the nano-antenna. So a little bit surprisingly, but we used the gold-coated cantilever, but we had the resonance in the green range rather than more in the red range. Then the approach curve, the enhancement factor versus cantilever oscillation amplitude. We can see the large enhancement only when we decrease the cantilever oscillation amplitude down to a few dozen of nanometers. This is again the proof of the near field effect of the tip localized effect of the enhancement. And the last thing to check, all the fundamental principles of the tip enhanced Raman sketching is the polarization factor. And as you can see on this model image, which I took from the literature, the vertically polarized light, the light with the E-vector component oriented along the tip, produces a very high localization of the localized surface plasma, very high intensity of the re-emitted localized laser light. While the same laser being focused at the horizontal polarization produces much less enhancement, and the enhancement is not localized at the tip, but is localized somewhere on the side. So the effective polarization for the tip enhanced Raman scattering is the polarization along the tip, the Z-polarized light, along the normal to the surface of the sample. So with this Z-polarized light, we can see a more than 12 times enhancement on the gold tip on the graphene, while with the same tip, with the same laser, and exactly the same conditions, but with a horizontally polarized light, we can see almost zero enhancement factor. So in this set of the images for the same sample, I showed you the basics of the tip-enhanced Raman experiment, physics, it should be a resonant excitation, it should be the localized excitation, should be the excitation of the tip with the right with the right polarization, and the tip must be very close to the sample to produce the enhancement. Then I'm very happy to show more data of NT-MDT customers. This is the data coming from the group of Renato Zinobbia, done by Johannes Stadler and Thomas Smith in ETH Zurich. And here they took a very challenging sample. This was the organic monolayer, the thin layer of brilliant crystal blue and Nile blue molecules mixed together and deposited by the spinner coater on the gold surface. So this is a very thin layer which by itself produces almost no Raman signal. So you can see the blue is the Raman spectrum without the enhancing tip. You don't basically see any Raman effect, because if you try to increase the laser power or to increase the acquisition time, the sample burns out, bleaches, because this is organic. But with this modest laser power, there is not enough signal at all from this organics to produce Raman signal. While with the enhancement, this is again hot point mapping. The laser scan across the cantilever area, and this is the hot point. Intensity of the Raman is greatly enhanced here, and you can see the many orders of magnitude, up to 5 orders of magnitude enhancement, maybe 3 or 4 orders of magnitude enhancement of the Raman bands specific to the Nile blue molecules. So now it's possible to do the mapping, and this is the corresponding map, which shows us the topography of the gold substrate by orange color and the intensity of the Nile blue specific Raman band. And we can see that the Nile blue is non-uniformly distributed on the sample. And we can see that in some places the distribution of the molecules is correlated with the topography of the surface. So here we can see the trench in the topography, and at the same time we can see more molecules here. At the same time, in some other areas, on totally flat areas of the sample, the researchers also can see non-uniform distribution of the molecules. So this is not a topography-related effect. This is the true chemical distribution of the organic molecules on the sample. This experiment is done, again, in the so-called gap-mode geometry. This is when the tip itself is a Raman active. This was the gold tip in STM regime, and the sample was a gold surface, also plasmon active or and conducting surface, but not TERS active, just the conducting surface. The surface itself did not produce any TERS effect, but it helped to increase the enhancement from the tip itself. And on the top of the surface, there was the thin layer of the molecule. So in this gap mode configuration, the enhancement factors reach many orders of magnitude and allow to see the organics which cannot be basically seen or imaged by the classical confocal Raman techniques. The next experiment comes from the same group, and here is graphene mapping. This is the CVD graphene pool which is put on the copper substrate, and here you can see the high resolution Raman map. The green color is the intensity of the 2D band, which shows us the distribution of the pristine clean graphene layer. Even though it's supposed to be the monolayer across the whole sample, the nano-Raman imaging shows us that actually this is not the case, because there are also the blue areas where there is very strong intensity of the CH band, and it tells us that there are areas of the CH-terminated graphene. And all this can be observed with about 10 nanometer lateral resolution and with extremely high signal enhancement and Raman sensitivity. The second experiment is done with the graphene on the gold substrate, and here the red color represents the intensity of the D-band and tells us that this is the areas inside the monolayer with a very high defect density. Again, the resolution is very high here. So in this experiment, the ETH group used a very specially prepared tips of their special recipe, and it can be found in the corresponding literature here, the references given. And the last slide I'd like to show for the tip-enhanced Raman scattering is the application in the semiconductor industry. Of course, there are a lot of desire in the, for the semiconductor industry to look at the silicon germanium chips on the nanometer scale. And this is our, this is the paper of done on the NT-MDT equipment by the group in the Fraunhofer CNT and AMD with a, some collaboration with NT-MDT. And here we can see the periodic silicon germanium structure on the silicon substrate. There are areas with a thin silicon germanium layer which is supposed to be fully strained, and the areas with the thicker mesostructures structures where the silicon germanium should be only partially strained. And the period of the structure is 95 nanometers, so this is well below the diffraction limit of the optics. So to resolve the structure, we need to apply the tip-enhanced Raman scattering. And here is corresponding data. On the top is the topography of the sample, the way I can see the line structure. On the bottom is the silicon germanium band intensity, which correlates very well with the structure. We can see a higher silicon germanium band at the lines and smaller silicon germanium band at the spaces. And of course, the most interesting thing to see is to see the stress state of the lines and of the thin layers. And to do that, here are shown two spectra. The black spectrum is the spectrum taken from the thin part of the sample of the silicon germanium layer. It shows here the silicon germanium Raman band at a certain frequency, while in the line structure, the silicon germanium band has a completely different frequency. And this allows to recalculate this position of the Raman band directly into the stress values of this partially strained silicon germanium layer and the fully strained silicon germanium layer. And this can be, this experiment, this stress identification is done with a resolution which is at least 50 nanometers, because this is 95 nanometer structure which is well resolved. So I would like to summarize here the talk, and I tried to demonstrate first of all that NT-MDT is producing the commercially the AFM-Raman instrumentation which is specially optimized for routine tip-enhanced Raman or nano-Raman experiments. The bottleneck behind the TERS in worldwide on the home-built systems or on a commercial system still remains the reproducibility and the quality of TERS tips. So for imaging purposes, for imaging, I'm talking not about the point spectroscopy, which is relatively easy technique. The imaging is hard and requires gives requirements for the system and most importantly for the TERS tips. So from the point of view of imaging, the bottleneck is the TERS tips, but probably and the things are moving forward very fast, and we expect the time where the TERS tips will be easily commercially available and they will be reproducible and produce reproducible data as reproducible as SNOM is doing, for example. Meanwhile, I try to show that more and more types of samples are very successfully imaged, which means we get the 2D maps, imaged by tip-enhanced Raman with a lateral resolution approaching 10 nanometers. At the end, I would like to announce also an upcoming webinar on the magnetic force microscopy, which will be performed by the world-renowned expert Sergei Dimakritov. He's a professor of Institute of Applied Physics of University of Münster. The webinar will be held on July 25th, and you can find all the information about the webinar and subscribe to the webinar on the webinarsntmdt.com. Also, you can see the webinar announcement, this and other webinar announcements on our website. Thank you very much for your attention. At this point, I stop the presentation, and I would like to answer your questions. Please give me just a few 1 minute to look to look at the questions, So probably at the moment we have no questions. Maybe I did not actually announce that you can ask your questions in the special window in the software. So you can type the questions if you want, and if I see any of them, I will reply now. Okay, so we have a few questions. I will just reply a couple of them, and the rest of them I will reply in the email because we need to finish actually. So the question about using the UV light for the tip and fence Raman scattering, yes, this is a very promising approach. It's interesting to use aluminum with a aluminum with the ultraviolet excitation for tip and fence Raman scattering, and we do have such system and customers doing that. Infrared is also possible. The question about tips reproducibility, I probably already replied to that. About precision of the tip positioning with respect to the laser spot, yes, we can do it very precisely, and the experimental, the physical conditions behind the tip and fence Raman experiment require that this tip position precision is maybe a dozen of nanometers, at least a few dozen of nanometers. And in order to make the reproducible Raman experiments, it's necessary to do this tip positioning very reproducibly with the piezo scanners. So we will reply more questions by the email, and then I would like to thank you very much for coming here and goodbye.